Bristol Community College, Mathematics with Dan Avedikian, Math 119, Fundamental Statistics, Section 2.1, Problem 1. This is Section 2.1, Problem Number 1. It says, consider the following group of incoming students and their schedules. So student 1 takes English, math, and history. Student 2 takes only English. Student 3 takes math, history, and sociology. Student 4 takes English, math, history, and science. Student 5 takes English, math, history, and sociology. Student 6 takes only math. Student 7 takes math and science. Student 8 takes English, science, and history. Student 9 takes English, math, history, sociology, and science, big schedule. And finally, student 10 takes English and science. So based on that information for these 10 students, we want to answer four questions, parts A through D. The first one is create a frequency table that shows the number of students taking each type of course, so how many students taking math, how many students taking science, etc. Create a relative frequency table for the number of students taking each type of course, and draw a bar graph for the frequency table in part A, and draw a Pareto for the frequency table in part A. So those are the four parts that we have to do with the information about those 10 students. So for part A, a frequency table, what we want to do is make a little table with two columns. One column will list the type of courses. So some students are signed up for English. Some students are signed up for math. Some are taking history. Some have sociology. And finally, some have science. And you can label that column if you like, the type of course. And the second column will be frequency. How many students are signed up for English? So if you go back to the original information and examine each student, you'll count up 7 students that have English as part of their schedule. So that gets a 7. Math, if you count how many students are signed up for math and you count through the list, you'll also see that there are 7 signed up for math. Now for history, if you count how many are signed up for history, you get 6 as I look at the list that's next to me. If you count next how many students are signed up for sociology, there are 3. And finally, if you count how many students are signed up for science, I count 5. So that's the answer to part A. This would be a frequency table for how many students are taking each type of course. So now part B says make a relative frequency table. So it's going to look exactly the same. This was a frequency table. B is going to have 3 columns though. So you'll have the course, still the frequency, and the last column will be relative frequency, which I kind of abbreviate for relative frequency. So again, the first course is English. It doesn't matter what order you list them in. The next one is math. Then we have history. Then sociology. And then science. And the frequency is the same. There's still 7 students taking English, 7 students taking math, 6 students taking history, 3 students taking sociology, and 5 students taking science. Now, here's where it gets a little bit different from part A. It says relative frequency. So what we need to do is know the total number of students, the total number of classes. I know there's 10 students, but the total classes, and then we're going to have that many over the total for each group. So 7 and 7 is 14. 14 plus 6 is 20. 20 plus 3 is 23. 23 plus 5 is 28. So, For English, the relative frequency would be the frequency for English, which is 7, over the total, which is 28. For math, you're going to have the frequency for math, which is 7, over the total, which is 28. For history, you're going to have the frequency for history, which is 6, over the total, which is 28. For sociology, you'll have the frequency for sociology over the total, which is 28. And finally, for science, you will have the frequency for science, which is 5, over the total, which is 28. So the relative frequencies can be expressed as fractions. One advantage to that is you can more easily see if they add up to 1. If you add them up, you have common denominators, it will add up to 28 over 28, which is 1. If you prefer decimals or percents, easy enough with a calculator. For example, English, 7 over 28 on your calculator, you could do 7 divided by 28, and the calculator will tell you that's 0.25. Or you could write it as 25%. So you can leave the fractions, you can very easily convert them to decimals if you prefer. But those are the relative frequencies, either in their fractional or decimal form. So, part C says draw a bar graph for the information that's in your frequency table. So, my biggest bar will go up to a height of 7. So, as a number scale, one at a time up to at least 7 is good. My bars for a bar graph can be drawn horizontally or vertically. I get to choose. And they should not touch. There should be a little bit of a space between the bars for a bar graph. So, I'll draw my bars vertically. My number scale should go at least up to 7. A little more is okay. I have one extra line on my number scale. So the first bar for English will go up to a height of 7 because there are 7 students signed up for English. So I will have a bar that goes up to a height of 7. I decided to do it vertically. I should label my bar. You can write it underneath too, or you can write it right in the bar if you like. And the next category is math. It also goes up to 7. So there'll be a bar right next to the English bar at the same height of 7. Vertical. Notice the bars do not touch. I will label it. Now the next bar is history. It will go up to a height of 6. So my 6 is right there. The next bar is sociology. There are 3 students registered for sociology, so it will have a bar that will go up to a height of 3. And I'll just abbreviate the sociology SOC. And finally, the last category is science. It will go up to a height of 5 because that's how many students signed up for a science class. I'll kind of abbreviate that too. So that's a bar graph. I chose to do the bars vertically. They could have gone horizontally. I didn't have to have any interval for my number scale. So if my biggest number was, say, 75, I could make 75 lines, but I would rather go by maybe tens. But where the biggest bar is 7, that was fine. They're labeled. So the last question, or the last part of this question, is draw a Pareto for the frequency table. So a Pareto is simply a bar graph where the bars go in order of height. This is not quite a Pareto. It's good up to this point, but the science and sociology really have to switch positions in order to make it a Pareto. So it'll be very similar. I'll have a number scale on the side again. I can still do English first with a height of 7. I can still do math next with a height of 7. And these could have gone in either order because they're the same height. History will still come next with a height of 6. About there. But now to make the next one a Pareto, I have to put science next. I have to make the bars go down in order of height. So science had a height of 5. So looking at my number scale, that's about 5. I'll label my bar as science. And then sociology, being the shortest one at 3, will have to come last on my bar graph, which again I'll just abbreviate. So now it's a Pareto because the bars are arranged in decreasing order of height.